Hello, I'm Sean Huskamp.
And I'm Monsignor Charles Minor. Welcome to Reel to Reel.
We're so glad you could join us in Reel to Reel. You know, Monsignor, this summer has been very special for me because my two-year-old son and my husband and I have moved into a new home, and we're enjoying the summer a lot.
Well, you enjoy the summer a lot with your family, and especially with your baby. It's also important not to take anything from your enjoyment, to consider the lack of joy of many women who desire children. And that brings up a special issue we'd like to address it tonight, surrogate mothering.
In our first story tonight, we'll meet some local people who are involved with the controversial issue of surrogate mothering.
And then we'll travel to New York to learn how fresh flowers are helping young offenders go straight. In the short segments, Liz Andre takes us to the Twilight Zone for a movie review, and Father Jim Young visits with some thoughts about our expectations.
One of the purposes of marriage is procreation. But in recent years, the rising rate of infertility for men and women has prompted some professionals to seek alternatives to the natural process. One such alternative is surrogate mothering.
10, 20, 50 babies a year we can provide. So we're not going to solve the infertility crisis in our office.
Certainly, procreation is considered to be, in true marriage, a worthwhile value, but not procreation at any price.
Because in adoption, both parents are even. Here, it is biased towards the husband, just by the nature of the process.
It's a choice of surrogate mothers type of a consumer mentality. And so therefore, again, it takes away from the personal worth of that child. That the idea is they want it to have a baby for themselves, not for the baby's sake. You know, that this was...
Infertility and marriage. No longer is it a quietly discussed subject. Changes in medical technology now offer new hope to infertile couples. And marriages, which once teetered on divorce due to frustrated attempts at conception, are now renewed through new drugs and delicate surgery. But only a small number of infertility problems can be cured medically. Other alternatives include artificial insemination and in vitro fertilization, where life begins outside of natural intercourse. One alternative that is causing widespread controversy is surrogate mothering. Companies that specialize in supervising this service for a fee are forming all over the country. The first on the East Coast is Surrogate Mothering Limited, legally initiated by this man, Burton Satzberg.
Well, we initially have a lengthy interview with the couple, review with them their background and the procedures by which our company works. The couple asks us a number of questions, we ask them a number of questions, and if they are interested in pursuing our program, we advise them that there are three requirements they must fulfill. We must have evidence of a valid marriage between the husband and wife. We must have evidence of female infertility. And we must have a current laboratory analysis showing that the husband has a normal active sperm count. We understand that we are, in effect, the court of last resort for these couples. They've exhausted fertility workup. They've exhausted adoption efforts. They come to us when all else has failed, and they're basically desperate for a child.
Dr. Howard Edelman is a clinical psychologist and is responsible for evaluating and counseling applicants in the surrogate mothering program.
What we do then is initially give the surrogate a machine-scored screening inventory just to get a overview of what's going on with the surrogate's personality. After that, I go into the surrogate's background, why she wants to be a surrogate, tell me about your parents, what's your mother like, what's your father like. We get into her motivations, what she's doing in her life right now. And basically what I'm looking for is to rule out people rather than to rule them in. If a person has
all medical responsibilities for Surrogate Mothering Limited are handled by infertility specialist Dr. Michael Birnbaum.
Once she completes that part of the program, all the data that has been put together about her is assembled into a package and given to Mr. Burton Satzberg, one of our attorneys, who then presents this data to couples who are looking for a surrogate. And then based upon all that data, the couple will select a surrogate that they that meets their criteria. Then the next step is to carry out the artificial insemination program until the surrogate becomes pregnant.
Biology alone does not a parent make. I think it goes more into the raising of children, what makes a parent, not just the biology of it. So I'm sure there might be a curiosity on the part, well, I wonder what this woman was like that had me. I mean, really had me. But I don't think it would change my perception of the woman that's raised me. I don't think I'd think any less of her. In fact, I would probably think more of her and my father for doing what they did.
While this is a legally accepted process in many states, there are those who feel that morally and ethically, surrogate mothering goes against the basic laws of man, marriage, and society. Christian moral teaching takes a position against surrogate mothering because it is contrary to natural laws and the rights of married couples to procreate.
See, we believe, really, the children, unborn children, have a right and can make a legitimate claim on the biological parent with respect to love, a sense of trust, a sense of responsible paternity. And we believe that that child has the right to make that claim on a parent. But in surrogate mothering, what happens is this. In principle, the surrogate mother simply cuts that and says, I don't claim any responsibility for you other than the period of gestation for 9 months. Beyond that, any psychological or spiritual tie I have with you, I have now severed that. In point of fact, it is from our perspective as a Catholic Christian faith that no parent can unilaterally sever that relationship. Oh, in point of fact, I know a lot of...
One reason is because surrogate mothering involves the act of artificial insemination. Pope Pius XII, in 1956, addressed the World Congress on Fertility and Sterility, saying, "We absolutely condemn insemination between people who are not married to one another, and even between spouses. As for artificial insemination between unmarried persons, we declared in 1949 that this practice violates the principle of the natural law that new life may be procreated only in a valid marriage." Future implications of one woman carrying a baby for another need careful scrutiny, believes Dr. George E. Sayu.
Now, once you establish that it can be done for money, you look at the larger social order, why should it be done only for the infertile couple?
Dr. Isayu is a doctor of internal medicine, active in the pro-life movement, and former president of the Catholic Physicians Guild.
You know, when contraception was first devised, the pill and other methods, they said this is only for stable marriages where people have good, serious reasons to avoid conceiving another child. That's how it was propagated in the beginning. Today, as you and I well know, free birth control pills are given to young 13, 14-year-old unmarried teenagers. And this is how far we've come in 20 years. And I believe the same thing will happen. Now, what is to stop a couple who the woman simply doesn't want to go through pregnancy? She's not infertile, or she is infertile by choice. She's had a tubal ligation, or she's making an effort not to conceive, and simply say, we will hire someone else to have our baby for us.
So how does one decide on an issue when both sides seem to make sense? Finding an answer means looking beyond the surface information. It is not an easy issue to resolve, and maybe only time will tell. Here are a few more things to think about on surrogate mothering.
I really believe that we're helping people. We're not hurting anyone. We're not damaging the moral fiber of anyone. We are not trying to convert anyone. We are offering a service that a couple has the right to seek out or not to seek out.
What we're objecting to specifically is that a biological parent, in principle, severs a tie with the child, and therein lies the harm. We have no way of measuring down the line 10, 15, 20, 30 years, a whole two generations from now, what is the impact on surrogate mothering. So to say glibly, who's to say that there's any harm? There doesn't appear to be any harm. It's an extremely short-sighted approach to this whole problem. So I don't think all the data is in yet. I don't, though, say that you have to wait for every piece of data to come in, but to be this rash this quickly, I think thinking persons would ask you to consider other alternatives in the medical profession helping infertile couples become pregnant.
The surrogate is being paid a fee for a service, not for the baby, for the very simple reason that she receives a fee regardless of what happens. In other words, if she goes full term and unfortunately the baby is a stillborn, she still receives her fee. If she delivers a baby that has a major congenital abnormality, she still receives her fee. If, on the other hand, she delivers twins, she doesn't get twice her fee. She's receiving a fee for a specific service, not for what the necessary outcome is.
He looks at his child, who may look a little bit like him and a little bit like the surrogate mother. So there's always this wonder as who was this person? I assume he would not know, but this interference with that memory of who was that mother who accepted my sperm, my seed, my genes for this baby. I think that will have a negative influence on the relationship.
Surrogate mothering is the modern solution to the problem of infertility. As medical science increases its knowledge of the human body, perhaps procreation can be a natural process for all couples. Coming up in Arts Review, Liz Andre takes us into the Twilight Zone. And in DABAR, Father Jim Young shares some thoughts about exceeding our expectations. Stay with us.
Finally, the long-awaited release of Twilight Zone, the movie. Hi, I'm Liz Andre. This week on Arts Review, we'll take a look at the film starring Dan Aykroyd, Albert Brooks, Scatman Crothers, John Lithgow, Vic Morrow, and Kathleen Quinlan. Each of the movie's four segments illustrates the power of the human mind. Often we don't really understand the suffering of someone else. In the film's opening episode, a bigot is mysteriously mistaken for a Jew, a Black, and an Oriental. He suddenly experiences the power of hatred as he himself is persecuted. The second episode is a magical tale about the power of hope and the capacity to see the possibilities in life instead of only the restrictions. Here, one elderly man helps the residents of a nursing home to regain their youth. Power is neither good nor bad. It's all in how you handle it. The third segment features a young woman who tries to persuade a little boy, gifted with an incredible imagination, to use his supernatural force constructively. The final episode deals with the unpredictable power of fear. It can either immobilize you or spur a person on to heroic action. In this story, a passenger who is afraid of flying becomes hysterical during a thunderstorm. But through his panic, he acts to save the plane from crashing.
Thank you. display!
Twilight Zone, the movie, is rated PG. It's not recommended for children young enough to be truly frightened by supernatural stories. Adolescents and adults will find it entertaining. I'm Liz Andre, and that's this week's Arts Review.
Cardinal Basil Hume of London, England, tells a story about when he was a boy, he would often sneak into his mother's kitchen to steal an apple. And when he would get in the kitchen, he'd often be stopped in his tracks, thinking that God was up there, watching him, frowning, waving his finger, and saying, "Don't take it." The cardinal says, now that he's become an adult Christian, he realizes that it is much more likely that if he went to take that apple, God would lean down and whisper, "Why don't you take two?" The cardinal says, that's the good news, that God always exceeds our expectations, always rewards us and touches our lives in ways far beyond our dreaming. When we were children, we all learned about God somehow as the great white-bearded man up there above it all, keeping track, looking down upon us, keeping score of our every little fault and failing on some giant tote board in the sky. That's not the God revealed to us by Jesus Christ. He came to earth to help us understand that God is near. God's not the great outsider. He's the great insider. In him we live and move and have our being. He's right here with us, part of our becoming, part of our struggles, part of our struggle to grow and become better people. He's here urging us on, supporting us and nourishing us. He is never far from us at all. Each one of us has times when we think that God seems distant, remote, and far away. The next time you have that feeling, stop, pray, listen, and I'm sure you may hear God saying, "Why don't you take two?"
But most of them were jobs that were cleaning up after people, that constantly reinforced their own, I guess, low esteem of themselves.
Here in the midst of summer, the world around us is highly decorated with God's great gift of flowers. And up in New York, that same gift is helping young people to stay out of trouble.
I was convinced that the criminal justice system just didn't work. I felt that kids who came into the criminal justice system were put off by the system. They weren't listened to. And they had no means of employment. And so what I tried to do was to get kids when they first got involved with the law, and to give them some type of a future.
It started when me and three more guys were stopped in a stolen car, which we really didn't know was stolen. We went to court and everything, and we were given what they call a second chance. Well, I won't say I'd be back in jail, but I couldn't say where I would be either. I mean, I may still be out on the street, maybe hustling, like some of the other kids in my neighborhood do.
New York City, the mercantile hub of the world, a maze of brick, cement, and people. A metropolis where millions are made and just as easily lost. The surrounding towns thrive on New York City, but also suffer the cold, impersonal nature of this jungle. Nearby Queens is made up of a potpourri of nationalities and economic classes. Queens also prospers from the proximity of the city and suffers from its rejections.
We have kids from all over the city come to us. They hear about us on the streets. They hear about us in the courts. It's the problem of the city itself, of growing up in the city. It's the problem of numbers. We're dealing with so many that most of these kids are just brought from agency to agency to agency, or even in the courts, they're not even listened to. And this is one of the big problems that we have, is to get a kid young enough and yet to be able to sit down and to take the time to listen to them.
Sam Williams is one of the many youngsters lucky enough to have been given a second chance with the Flowers with Care program of the Diocese of Brooklyn. This organization strives to provide troubled youths and first offenders with a positive and a practical means of redirecting their lives. They do this by counseling, upgrading their educational levels, and finally, job placement in the floral industry.
I looked at the inmate and I saw that the inmate was given a lot of jobs, but most of them were jobs that were cleaning up after people, that constantly reinforced their own, I guess, low esteem of themselves, car wash or a dishwasher or whatever. But most of the jobs had no hands-on skill that they could say was a future. And so we went to the Department of Labor and we asked them what was a marketable job skill for this type of an individual. They came back with fast food management and floral design. And I said, well, I hate the smell of hamburgers, so let's try floral design.
I didn't know much about them. I knew, you know, basically a few things about taking care of green plants, but flowers, I didn't know anything at all. But when I got here, I learned, you know, Vic and his wife Sharon and everybody that was here taught me what I needed to know. I still need to know more, but I'm working on it.
Vic Follander, owner of Follander's Flowers, is Sam's employer. Like many other florists in the New York metropolitan area, he is a member of the Flowers with Care program.
I'm a very active florist. I go to a lot of business meetings. And at one meeting, Father Harvey was there with a few florists that I knew well. And he was talking about this new program he was trying to bring into existence. And it was in existence, actually. And he asked if I would be interested in hiring somebody who would come through the program. Well, I was a little worried, knowing, though, that everybody was supposedly screened before they came. And it sounded good.
The background of most of the kids are really shattered homes and what we prefer to call throwaway kids. That is, kids who don't choose to run, but who are thrown away by their parents. Most of the kids are dropouts. About 60% of them are totally illiterate. At 16 to 18 years of age, they're totally illiterate. They can't read or write.
The first thing we have to do is get your reading scores up.
Yeah.
Because that's an important criteria, first of all, for your daily living, secondly, for taking the high school equivalency test.
I've took it before, and I failed it because I never did reading, you know, when I went to PS10.
Mm-hmm. Well, Sister Patricia Bryant is my associate director. She runs the day-to-day operation of Flowers with Care. And we are convinced that the one thing that is going to make Flowers with Care work is that when a kid comes here, number one, they feel welcome, and number two, that they obviously see care and concern, that we are here for them, that they're not coming here to provide us something to do, that we are here to service them. And so the one thing that really is key for us is an obvious love of the kids.
About 5 or 10 years from now, where do you see yourself?
Right now, mm-hmm. From this point, nowhere.
Nowhere. Okay, no idea whatsoever what you would like to be doing, what career you would like to be in.
No, not right now. I would like to be a carpenter, you know, get into wood and all that.
You like to work with your hands?
Yeah.
All right, so that's a start.
Try and make a kid aware of the strengths that they have. Try and make a kid aware that they can make it and that there are people behind them to make it. And to give them that insight into themselves.
Hello.
Hi. Is my arrangement ready?
What's your name?
Fitzpatrick.
Yes, it is. How's that?
Beautiful. Okay, I'd like to charge that.
Regina Fitzpatrick?
Right.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Have a nice day now. I'm feeling better about myself. I'm off the street. I'm more relaxed. I'm able to take care of myself better, and gives me a goal to reach for. And maybe I'll be a florist someday.
Eventually, he could be a really good designer with a little bit more training. He's knowledgeable in a lot of areas now of the flower industry. He can certainly wait on customers and take care of the phone business. He knows about the wire services. He can send flowers via computer now to other florists. And he works out well.
To provide a graduate equivalency program and adequate job training, it cost Flowers with Care $1,000 per youngster. It cost the city of New York $27,000 to keep that same youngster in jail. Flowers with Care is an agent of change, which restores a sense of dignity and pride to those who have experienced their loss, giving them hope for the future.
Renewal, reformation, rehabilitation, their words would signify a lot of work, and they are. It's so nice to see, though, in that story of rehabilitation, how the young man's life is symbolized in the flowers with which he works. And when I think of flowers or see them, I think of recreation and rest and peace, somewhat like you see in the flowering of your own family, Sean. You have enjoyed them so.
That's true. And summer is a great time for vacation. Reel to Reel is going on vacation, and we hope you'll join us for the first show of our new season, September 4th. Until then, everyone for the show hopes that you enjoy your month of August.
Goodbye, and God bless you.
Good night.